Sorry.
Okay, I'll give you the mic.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay. So please come back and before the session starts, there is a quick announcement. There are two quick announcements. So first, we didn't clarify that, but for the upcoming talks, so the chairs, please for the chairs of the sessions, please remind the people with that 5 minutes sign when it's 20 minutes. So and then there was a sign for 1 minute, and there is a sign for time is up. So time is up means 25 minutes. So there is still 5 minutes for questions. So just in case, so just to clarify that. So we have 30 minutes for each talk. And another announcement is we are going to collect the files for the talks. Of course, that's optional if you are willing to share with us. Jingyuan Chen is our postdoc is going to help collecting the slides. So maybe Jingyuan can come here. So yeah, so that you see when he try to collect slides from you, he's not suspicious.
Good morning. Good morning. My name is Akira Furusaki from Riken, Japan. And it's my pleasure and honor to chair this second morning session. Before starting the session, let me say a few more words. So I was in the Shuchan's group as a visiting scientist in 1998. And so that was the era of SO5. And I met Eugene and Yaroslav and Jumping. And I had a great time at Stanford. And I just want to say that I'm grateful to Shuchan for giving me the opportunity to join his group. And also he gave me many advices and encouragements over the years. So that I'm also grateful for that. So having said that, I would like to call the first speaker, Professor Claudio Felser from Max Planck Institute.
Yeah, thank you very much. I'm also extremely happy to be here. And I was also visiting scientists in Sushen's group for sabbatical, which really changed my life. And this is a very nice photo in the garden of Steve Kiffelsen, made by his wife, I have to say, even. So we had this very nice background during this discussion. So I, since I'm here, and I do a lot on topology, but I decided finally to talk about more where I come from, about Häusler compounds, because they have a lot of contribution nowadays to topology, and but I want to bring it in the context. So I think I'm well known for this Häusler compounds. I make this material, and this material, as you can imagine, are fitting very well in the row of semiconductors, starting from diamond, binary semiconductors, and then the half-Häuslers, so-called half-Häuslers, are ternary semiconductors. But since you have three atoms, you have more trouble, but also you have more fun because you can mix more or less the whole periodic table into these compounds. And then there's a full Häuslers, which are very good magnet, up to 1200 Kelvin and higher. So they have two magnetic sublattices. So they are semiconductor and magnet. So it opens new direction. And you can, as I said, use a full periodic table. If you see the color code here, so for the Kafli lecture this year, I had to talk about Legos and Häuslers. So this was a to-do from Paul Canfield. So I therefore built up all these Legos. And you will see some Legos again, but I don't follow fully the Kafli talk. So this family of Häuslers can be very useful for topology because you can tune them. And I don't want to go through this list. I want to simply start first with the half Häuslers, and then you will recognize that we can more or less have everything. We can have everything in magnetism, skirmions, and so on by design. So you give me the Hamiltonian, and this was what I did in the Kafli lecture, starting with a Hamiltonian for skirmion system and showing how I tune the material to make a skirmion system. So as I said, it's obvious that the half-Häuslers, these ternary compounds, are strongly related to the binary semiconductors like mercury telluride. And mercury telluride is a 2,6 semiconductor, so you can now immediately recognize that I can, for example, make a 1,2,5 semiconductor, which has a similar band structure like mercury telluride. And the nice things of Häuslers is, and therefore the Häuslers can also be magnetic, they even can host F and D electrons. So the F electrons I ignore because here in many of the compounds they are localized, and some because of Kondo and mixed valency they are not localized, but I can ignore. But the D electrons I even can count, and I can make very strange semiconductors. Like zirconium nickel tin, I make three metals and I have a semiconductor, and here we measured up with very clean single crystals and it has a 0.6 eV band gap. And you can make semiconductors from metal up to 2 eV band gaps. So this is surprising, but it's simply because this compound follows in the first approximation simply a single particle picture, and you count electrons and you bring them together in the right way so you can design semiconductors. And this was the starting point, as I said yesterday. So I was invited from Stuart because he was interested in spintronics, and you see in the second time when I become magnetic, and Albert Vett was there, so the spintronic community I was familiar to. And I not only met Shushen there for the first time and Brian, I got many new friends in a totally different community. And here today I have many collaborators sitting here, amazingly many collaborators on the experimental side also. So this was the starting point for me because I simply showed this Häusler compounds like I showed to you. And I showed this band structure so that we can make compounds which have a 2 eV band gap for solar cells. I made a patent later with Shushen on solar cells. But you can have also small band gap semiconductors. And for him, and I think also for Lawrence, it was obvious, immediately obvious, that this is a band inverted system and that we can use this. So the result was then I was invited for a sabbatical. And Stuart was hosting me at home in his house, so in his guest room. I want to say politically correct, in his guest room. And so Shushen, and they came regularly, and the result was this fantastic paper. So the good thing of Häuslers, there are many, and you can have many Häuslers which have no band inversion and Häuslers which have a band inversion. And the interesting thing, all these Häuslers with band inversion are superconductors, non-central symmetric superconductors, or magnetically interesting systems. So you can now understand, so was the slide, so the scheme which Lawrence liked to show, I simply rewrite it with three elements. So we have compounds where the gamma 6 band is above the Fermi energy, this compound, and we have compounds where the gamma 6 band is below the Fermi energy, and it was even later verified in collaboration with Julian Chen, who is now also friend, thanks to Shushen and my sabbatical. So you see here, below the Fermi energy, between the gamma 8 and the gamma 6 band, the band inversion, the Dirac cone in these materials. So then, being on a sabbatical with Shushen, we played with the compounds and the elements. So we thought, this is not very good for topological insulator, so because we have this degeneration and we make bulk materials, mostly we don't want to have the effort of Lawrence Mohren come to MBE growth, even we start now to do MBE growth. So you can split the degeneration by breaking the symmetry, and this is one case with the chalcopyrite, which are very nice solar cell materials, but if you make them heavier, you get a band structure like this. Or we thought also, why not going to heavy graphene, you know, because this is like diamond and graphene related, you can do the same. If you see the elements, they are very similar, like you have in the cubic Häusler compounds, and you can have this layered buggled or not buggled, so depending from the ratios of the atoms, etc. So we did this calculation, and this is also, again, very nice because I was introduced to Bin Haiyan, who was a postdoc in Shushen's group, and I had an undergraduate, Lukas Müssler. So we exchanged, so Bin Hai later joined my group, and Lukas went for 6 months to Stanford, and so the result were this weak topological insulators in this family, and you maybe have recognized that Andre Brunovic has written a very nice Nature paper about the what is this? I know only the German word, Eieruhr, surface state. Where's André? He doesn't listen to my talk. Anyway, so exactly. So now, after many more nice papers with Shoshan, we even recognized recently that the full Häuslers can be very interesting for topology as magnetic wire semi metals. And I want to explain you simply, if you go to this, I said always fully filled FCC lattices, so you go to composition like 2:1:1. And even in this family, you can make very strange non-magnetic semiconductors like iron 2, vanadium aluminium is a thermoelectric material, it's not magnetic, 50% iron. Surprising, but this is how it works in Häusler compounds. So the magic electron number also are 8. If it has no transition metal, 18. If it has one transition metal. And if you have two transition metals, the magic number for a semiconductor is 24. So we have a sketch of the band structure like this. This is really a non-magnetic semiconductor. So now if I put additional electrons only in one side, you can see this is then a half-metallic ferromagnet. So you have electrons only in one spin direction and a gap in the other spin direction. And I always say, this is the reason why Stuart married me, finally. At the beginning, he didn't believe in full Häuslers and half metallicity. Later, we could prove it by Apis, not by Apis, by photoemission. So, and then you can really simply count the electrons, and I can predict you which magnetic moment the compound has and which TC the compound has, because you increase simply exchange splitting if you put more and more electrons here, which means TC also increases. So like here, cobalt 2 manganese gallium, which you will see later as a nice Y semi-metal, has in total 28 valence electrons. So we have 4 mu-bor for the magnetic moment, as you see nicely here, 24. And then you have some additional leftover electrons only in one spin direction. So you see that many of these cobalt Häusler compounds follow this rule. So you measure magnetic moment, which is exactly the difference between 24 valence electrons plus the valence electrons the compound really has, as you see here in the example. So we can simply increase the magnetic moment, keep the half metallicity up to 6 mu-bor, and at the same time, we also increase TC. So as you see, we really increase TC with the number of valence electrons, which makes it very easy. So we even don't need the band structure calculation in a first approximation. So then in 2016, there were predictions. So people were bored of non-magnetic system. So they went to a magnetic system. There was a prediction from Andre Bernewicz's group and other that cobalt to titanium tin is a very nice white semi-metal. So as you see here in the band structure, this is for fully relativistic. You see these very nice crossing points in these compounds, which I would write cobalt 2 titanium tin because this is convention. And the interesting thing is, you know about whites already from Lorentz talk, so I don't have to talk too much. So this is, if I have a Dirac crossing and if I break symmetry or if I break time reversal symmetry, so if I have a ferromagnetic compound, every crossing point is a white. So which is good news, because there's an inflation of whites in this compound, in all the magnetic materials, but so far I think people didn't look really careful also in oxide and other systems. So you see here you really have the white crossings in this compound, and but they are above the Fermi energy, so you don't see it really. You know, it's difficult, they are quite a bit above the Fermi energy. So we worked on this compound, but we remembered that there's another compound, and even in 2012, I worked with Jürgen Kübler, who was also at the meeting in Fallen Leaf. So we simply calculated the Berry curvature of Häusler compounds and other compounds to get large anomalous Hall effect, and we have a patent here on this on Hall sensors, because here you see also there's a nice crossing point in this compound, and this is the calculated value from the Berry curvature, the anomalous Hall effect, and this is measured, and it's a giant value. But at this time, we were not aware why this was so giant. We mentioned in the paper in 2012 that it seems to be when you have crossing points, you have higher values of the Berry curvature and higher values of the anomalous Hall effect, but we didn't see the direct connection. But then later, we revisited the compound 2016, and we really could show that this is a very nice white point, and this is responsible for the high anomalous Hall effect. So to look now in more depth into this compound, so cobalt 2 manganese gallium or cobalt 2 titanium tin, this is already two wild semimetals in the family of Häusler compound. You see it has a lot of symmetry, and you see here mirror planes everywhere. And in the reciprocal space, it has its nodal lines in all three directions because it's a cubic structure. And if you apply magnetic field in this magnetic material, you turn some of the nodal lines into wild points. So, and this is the reason why we have this giant anomalous Hall effect. This is a Hall measurement as a function of the magnetic field. And the signature of this giant Hall effect is a giant jump here in the Hall measurement, which is related to this Berry phase. So the Hall, the anomalous Hall angle is here already 10%, which is quite good, or larger than 10%. If you would go to higher temperature, it's probably even higher. So which already tells us we are not so far from the quantum anomalous Hall effect, but this compound shows is quite metallic. So therefore, we look for more compounds. But despite of this, we try to understand in general now what happens if we have wild points close to the Fermi energy. This is a little bit above the Fermi energy, so we get a peak in the Berry curvature. This leads to a real big peak in the anomalous Hall effect, but also in the anomalous Nernst effect. So therefore, we measured also the Nernst effect on this compound, and it's larger than all the Nernst effect in any magnetic compound. And as you see here, here's the Nernst effect as a function of temperature, and here as a function of magnetic field. You see it goes up and up and up. And since the TC of this compound is around 900 Kelvin, I even would say the value is doubled because it goes up until at TC it disappears. So Häusler was interested in this compound, so we gave him single crystals and thin films, and he showed the nodal line. Since this is a soft magnetic material, we cannot make it magnetic, so we have here really only the precursor of the wild points. So he showed the nodal this nice agreement with the calculation and the theoretical structure, and it shows the drum head like nodal line in this compound. So, we wanted to see. So it's nice to find big values, but has this something to do with topology, or is this more luck? And people discuss an anomalous Hall effect, extrinsic effect, which can also be play a big role. Maybe we only made dirty samples and thought have big effects. So we like to play with symmetry, so we can make this Häusler with two, the composition X2YZ, with inversion symmetry and without inversion symmetry. And we can make exactly the same band structure with and without inversion symmetry. So the elements are different, you know, because in this case, we have the cobalt 2 Häusler case, and we have the, here we have the manganese 2 Häusler compound, because manganese likes to sit here, cobalt likes to sit here. So if you have two manganese, for example, they sit then on different position, and with this we break the inversion symmetry. So we wanted to see whether we can break the wild points by reducing the symmetry. So and this is by comparing, here is in the comparison not with the same number of valence electrons, but with the same elements. So we make simply a compound which has much more manganese, and we remove with this mirror plane, which has a big influence on the Berry curvature. This is a picture of the Berry curvature in reciprocal space. And you see, since we have this mirror plane here, the value of the Berry curvature here on this side and there must be the same, because symmetry doesn't allow that they have different sign. The Berry curvature in this compound is also very big, but since there's no mirror plane here, so we can have different signs. The value is big, but different signs gives us the sum of the Berry curvature here zero. And it's amazing, so you can go from a big jump in the Berry curvature to zero. And you go also in the anomalous Hall effect from a large anomalous Hall effect to zero anomalous Hall effect in the compound, which has exactly in two compounds which have exactly the same magnetic moment. And if you compare here, for example, the band structure, you understand this, because here we have this very nice Y points crossing. Here's a, and we have a half metallic ferromagnetic gap in one spin direction if we don't think about spin orbit coupling. But anyway, even in the band structure of Andre, you saw nicely this Y points. And then if you go to the broken symmetry compound with no mirror plane, this crossing point, the band structure looks nearly the same, but the crossing points have disappeared because they were protected by this mirror plane. And it's nicely seen in the data, as you have seen. You can go from a big anomalous Hall effect to a zero anomalous Hall effect. So I was really amazed how good this works, I have to say. And I hope you are also convinced that topologies even seen in not only quantum effect, even in real space, and it has impact even on some interesting properties like Nernst effect. Okay, so then we also did a lot of work on tetragonal Häusler compounds. This was inspired also by Stuart's work because he demanded tetragonal Häusler compound because he wanted to have MRAM. And for MRAM, it's important that you have this for this new directions of MRAM, spin transfer torque and spin and so on. So they want to have out-of-plane magnetization. So Häuslers can go in this direction, especially the manganese 2, because of the Jahn-Teller distortion allows this. And it's interesting for many applications, and for one reason also, like hard magnets, we are looking for this. And you see, if you, these are films which are going from tetragonal to cubic, so you can make it from very hard to soft magnetic, and the motivation here was simply to do hard magnets or this. But then we were thinking we can also have a distortion in the direction of hexagonal if we simply distort this compound in the 111 direction, because many of these compounds, for example, we were working on, they simply appear in tetragonal, cubic, and hexagonal phase simply at which temperature you make them. Okay, you can make them cubic, hexagonal, and tetragonal. So this is very good because if you want to have this kind of compound, and this was interesting because the hexagonal compounds we started to work on because they have this Kagome lattice, and Kagome lattice is nice for frustration, and since I'm now more away from spintronic, more with this Kagome people and so on, I thought it's very nice. And at this time we saw a very nice paper from Alan MacDonald, who is here also, and he predicted that in this antiferromagnetic manganese iridium you can have a large anomalous Hall effect, and the common belief in the spintronics community was so if you have no magnetic moment, you have no anomalous Hall effect, and the anomalous Hall effect goes with the magnetization. But I have shown you this is already wrong. But here it was the example, and since we found an anomalous Hall effect in this compound, and Stuart didn't believe me, originally Stuart and Binhai were on the paper, they removed their name because they thought zero moment, no anomalous Hall effect. So anyway, we published this paper encouraged by Alan MacDonald in EPL, and saw really nice Y points in this compound. Anyway, so finally, this is an antiferromagnet where you really see you have no anomalous Hall effect. So we were working on this compound, still fighting with Binhai and Stuart that our compound is dirty or whatever, because we saw experimentally what was predicted. Then this paper came out which showed here really a nice large anomalous Hall effect in our compound. So we published shortly after then our paper also, including Stuart and Binhai on the paper. Okay, anyway. So this family, manganese 3 tin, can go further with iron 3 tin 2 or cobalt 3 tin 2 sulfide 2. So this opens even a new pathway to find new topological material like this Dirac Kagome or our otherwise semi metals, which we think is interesting not only because it has giant Fermi arcs, which you can see, this is my collaboration again with Julian Chen, who saw the Y points and the chiral transport, but since I have not so much time. It's also interesting, despite of also having a giant Nernst effect, similar like manganese 3 tin, all this compound which has this enhanced Berry curvature have much larger Nernst effect than all the other magnetic compounds. This is the Nernst effect as a function of magnetization. And as I said, people believe it goes linear. So this opens now even ways eventually to find giant Nernst effects for thermoelectric application. But at the same time, as I said, since also this cobalt 2, tin 2, sulfide 2 has even a Hall angle of 25% already, so we thought we are so close to anomalous Hall effect, can we make this compound maybe an anomalous Hall effect? And indeed, Jansson did very nice calculation, model calculation plus DFT calculation, and he prove that if we can make this compound very thin, we should have a very nice Anomalous Hall effect, which is nice because it's a real ferromagnet and not only a doped compound. So I skip the non-collinear spin structure because Stuart will talk about the nice commutes, I hope, and come shortly to the next, because this is also related to some theory papers of Shoshen. You heard already of about axion insulator, and with Andre we found a compound which has a band structure which looks like a hydrogen model for a band structure where you think, wow, this is finally the why, where we don't have to suffer with the referees because of electron and hole pockets. No, this compound is not a why because it opened up a band gap. But thanks to the experimental work of Johannes Goode, we could show, and the theoretical work of Andre, we could show that in this compound, the nesting vector of a charge density wave is exactly the distance of the y points, and therefore it opens up a band gap in our ideal band structure and has a charge density wave. But Johannes could slide the charge density wave and recover the wild physics and could show that this is an axion insulator. And I think this is maybe more common because maybe it's my what I see from logic, that if you have really a hydrogen-type band structure of a Y semi-metal, you always have a nesting between the Y points. So which means it's always the situation of the axion insulator. And there's also a paper of the perchlore iridate where people claim also they have a charge density wave and it's an axion insulator. So this is maybe even a way to find more interesting stuff. And this is my last slide to see in which direction you can go beyond of quantum devices. So I'm very interested now in catalysis with topological materials. This started with a paper of Binhai, and also showing that also gold is a topological insulator. If you increase the spin-orbit coupling, it's really becoming insulating. And that the surface state in gold and platinum are surface topological surface state. And motivated by this, and platinum is one of the best catalysts, so we started to look for more catalysts, and we looked for the catalytic activities of our Y semi-metals. We have now many more papers out. But I think what is essential is, like, the dream of chemists always was to change catalysis by a magnetic field, because then we maybe have access to break the symmetry in homogeneous catalysis. So we looked it up, and it looks like we can change in our Y semi-metal, we can change the catalytic activity in the magnetic field, which might give us access to even really interesting catalysis. Yeah, this is what I wanted to tell you. And all this work was done with my fantastic group and Shoshen especially, and the network which I got thanks to Shoshen. And you know, I'm even married thanks to Shoshen. So, and I thank you for your attention. Thank you.
Thank you for the beautiful talk. And questions or comments?
Yeah. Maybe I missed it, but in the axion insulator,
yeah,
what is the gap and what's the speed of that that well cone?
So the gap is here is around. I should ask Julien. He did the upper measurement. He's not here. He's not also not listening to my talk. 200 milliev.
200 milliev.
Yeah.
Oh, that's pretty big. And yeah. and so this cone also has a speed that's comparable with other well semi-metals.
So you see the band structure is quite linear, no?
Yeah, it's quite linear, but then it's quite broad because the correlation.
So therefore, we need to. So we can only close the gap by applying a voltage. So we slide the charge density wave, but then we see a negative magnetoresistance effect and the wild physics, which we see not with the charge density wave. But I saw similar data, is not of this quality, from the iridates, which were the first system. And nobody recognized this paper. It's published in PRL in 2008. So.
Other questions?
So are there other bulk materials where people have claimed to find axion insulator physics as opposed to in the thin film?
Yeah, you do oxides, do yes. The iridium.
Adrian.
This is in PRL 2018. I think nobody cites this paper because nobody finds it since it's not in
now
Nature.
We will. Now we will.
So I think this is a very nice system too. You might strain it or get the wild physics back by electrolyte gating or something.
Thank you.
But I'm sure there are many, many more. The reason why we think we have many more examples where theory predict Dirac or Weyl and where we find an insulator. So now we have to look more careful about the whether there is a charge density wave. Because I think this is my speculation, theory should help, you know. If you only have the Weyl points at the Fermi energy, then there should be a nesting. And then there should be a charge density wave, right? I don't know really very clean systems, like in oxides, where you have bigger gaps, where the Weyl point survives. And this might be an explanation. Now the expert.
Well, only it won't have it nesting for infinitesimal coupling. I mean, there's a zero density of state, so you need for a strong enough coupling, it can nest. Yeah.
Yeah, but oxides are strong enough coupled, and so it might be why we don't find oxides, you know? Why don't we find oxide topological insulators? And because they would have bigger gaps.
Yeah, just one more comment. Because even if the density of state is zero at the Weyl point, but if you turn on magnetic field and make it a lambda level, so because of the lambda level degeneracy, so this you don't need a critical interaction strength to make the CDW become instability.
Yeah, so
under the magnetic field.
Therefore, I think the experimentalists should simply look more for this non-really successful oxides, whether they have CW. Like this, people found it in the uridate. It's a 3-Indian. Nobody pays attention to this paper. I didn't know the authors, but I'm a material scientist. Sorry if there's somebody famous here in the audience.
Is there a quick question? Okay, then since the schedule is very tight, we'll go on to the next stop. Yeah, thank you. Thank you very much.